Okay. I guess we are live. So hi everyone and welcome to another High Interactives Masterclass. Today we are talking about how to design atomic interfaces. And I have my my name is João and I have my friend Rodrigo and my friend David with us to tell us their perspective on how to design atomic interfaces. David is our is High Interactives front-end lead and Rodrigo is one of our Interactive's UI design. So let's kickstart this masterclass. I hope you are all ready. And starting, I would like to thank everyone who stood by and is interested in this topic. And let's start by talking about the event and what we have planned for you today. So. Before we are going to talk a little bit about High Interactive, what we are and what we do, just briefly. Then we are talking about atomic design, what it is and how it works for. Then atomic design in the real world. Then we sum this up with a quick exercise that Rodrigo has prepared for you. We also are going to talk about style guides, some common errors when designing interfaces, and the advantages of using atomic design on the OutSystems platform. And as always, if you have attended two previous masterclasses, we have a short period of time in which we are going to answer all of the questions. Some of we already have because we have made some research on the community, and also questions that you may have, and I will advise you to put them on the chat box on this video. You have your chat box and you can put the questions there. After we are done with the presentation, we are going to start answer to all of them, so you can drop them whenever you want. Okay, so we have a lot to talk about, but first, let's talk about High Interactive, what we are and what we do. So if you have attended two previous masterclasses, you will know that our goal is to help other businesses producing the best digital experiences they can get. And of course, we do that by designing amazing user experiences, deliver beautiful applications whilst promoting scalability, consistency, and maintenance for the OutSystems platform. And speaking about OutSystems, as you can see on your screen, we work with them for many, many years now. We are a certified delivery partner, and our main focus with this partnership is front-end development. And talking about this main goal that we have, in which we call it at High Interactive, the wow experiences, what you can see right now on your screen, are the main points in which we tend to focus when producing this kind of quality digital experiences. As you have there, you have UX research, the UI design, UI architecture, front-end development, and this topic is very important for us if you have attended to other masterclass, because we are taking our first steps, our baby steps, into deliver full solutions. And also UI development, UX design, and without forgetting the quality part that plays the biggest role in these topics that I've mentioned. Then, minding these topics that I've talked about, we have some common actions that we deliver in every digital project. And you have them here, and I will start explaining them bit by bit. So by wireframing, this is one of the initial steps in the UX phase of our projects. It's the first thing that you can really see. The UI design, and this is where we conceive the prototype of the user interface design. And after this, magic starts to happen. Then themes and documentation, and this is where we start producing the library for developers to work on. And here you'll have it all for producing the wow experience, as I said before. The assessment reports, that this is a very important document in which we describe the state of the art of every client's applications. The UI architecture, and this is one of our main goals to success, I must say. The UI components, and this is important because we deliver them in two separate ways. The OutSystems UI components, fully customizable, and also the custom components. So And finally, the design system. When you have more than one type of communication, you should have a design system. A design system is a single place where you can manage and have available for all different stakeholders with all these multiple themes, UI assets, and so on. And this is basically high interactive, what I've just said. This is like high interactive in a nutshell. But without further to add to this, I would like to start the presentation and passing the ball to Rodrigo to start his amazing presentation on atomic design. So, Rodrigo, are you there?
Yeah. Hi. Hello. Hi, Rodrigo. So, hello, everyone. Hope you're doing well. So, as João already said, today we will be talking about atomic design. I don't know how many of you know about this methodology, but I guess that at least you already have heard this name, atomic design. And I will start by telling you what it is and how does it work. So let's go. Okay, so let's start by defining atomic design. Atomic design is basically a methodology that combines software development with the laws of chemistry. This methodology promotes interfaces that are easy to modify and easy to scale. This is not a process like other methodologies, but is a mental guide that after you learn, it changes the way you see interfaces. The purpose of this guide is to help you having in mind that the interfaces that you are developing are not just single products, but they are a collection of parts, collection of pieces. So these pieces can be categorized in three groups, the atoms, the molecules, and the organisms. And all of them play a key role in the hierarchy of our interface design systems. Using atomic logic enables you to create a system of pieces that can come together to create bigger elements, but they can be reused many times in many ways. Before we move on, I just want to make a quick disclaimer that there are many approaches on this methodology. In this masterclass today, we will talk about how we at Interactive adapted this methodology for our work with low-code development.
Exactly.
Okay, so I saw this quote, and I think it defines atomic design in a few words. It's by Stephen Hay, and he says that we are not designing pages, we are designing a system of components. So I think that in a few words, that's the best description of atomic design. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now that you already know the basic of what it is, atomic design, I will explain next how does it work and what is the logic behind atomic design. Okay, so what you are seeing in this slide is the atomic model in science. I will talk more about it on the next slides of each one. But shortly, the atom, the first one, is the most basic element. And then if you group atoms together, they can form molecules. And then if you group molecules, they can form organisms.
Exactly. Okay, so if you have missed the science classes, now you learn today something new.
Yeah, about atomic model. Okay, so I will start with atoms. This is the most basic unit of an element, and cannot be broken down more than this. And in interfaces, atoms are the HTML elements, the most basic pieces, like in science. The basic pieces of your system. A few examples of atoms are buttons, are titles, paragraphs, yeah, images, and many more. Okay, then in science, if you group, for example, two atoms of oxygen and two atoms of hydrogen, you will have a molecule of water. And the same applies in interfaces. So molecules are basically simple groups of your elements. Like, for example, if you group an image, a title and a text paragraph together, you can create a card. And this card is a molecule. Okay, so back to science, and I hope that this balance between science and interfaces is not too complex to understand, but I want to merge the two things and to make you understand what is meant in science and then what is meant in interfaces. So in science, if you group multiple molecules and atoms together, you can create even bigger and more complex structures. And that can go from a single-celled organism all the way up to a human being. Human being is also an organism, a complex structure of other elements. And then in interfaces, like in science, if you group multiple molecules and atoms, you can create more complex pieces of your interface. And this is where you start to see your interface really come together. These organisms can be only a single section of your page, and they can be also a fully structured page with all the elements inside.
Exactly. So our organism, in the basic model, organism can be a page, but also a section. So part of a piece of your page that repeats in another page can be organism also, right?
Yeah, exactly. Are complex groups of other molecules and all other atoms, basically.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, and there you have it. Like you saw in the previous slide, atoms are HTML elements, molecules are components, and then organisms are pages or a section of a page.
So the science model can be synced with a tech model.
Yeah. Technological model. Exactly. But okay, we already saw that, but there is still one thing missing. If we are talking about design, how do we style these elements? How the design part, the style part, enter in all of this methodology? So the logic behind this is that all the styles, and it can be styles like colors, styles like typography, styles like shadows, are applied to the HTML elements, as you can see on the graphic. They can be applied in the HTML elements or atoms. And then the atoms instances presented on the molecules and on the organisms will drink from the styles of the main atom.
Mm-hmm.
There are some things like if you can actually apply styles to the component itself, like exception. The main purpose is to style, make styles to the elements, mm-hmm. and then the components will drink from the atoms.
So the first step is ensure that all elements and every element have their own styles.
Mm-hmm.
When you are using an element to create a component, okay, the elements already have styles, but you can add some specification styles for this element inside this component. So when I'm using a title, for example, a heading 2 inside the cards, I can set specific rules for this element. But in the first moment, heading 2 already have the own styles. This is the main guide. So you can apply styles in the components, but in the elements inside the components, this is the rule. So you apply styles only to elements, but you can apply specifications when the components are working together, are merging together.
Yeah, so the components will drink from the styles that are applied in the elements, but you can make actually some exceptions on the component itself and change these styles.
Yes, let me say something. It's common to it's a mistake that I've found many times. It's apply styles to a specific element inside the page. Don't do it, because you are setting a rule. Okay, this component or these elements that we are using inside this page have these styles. Don't do it, because this way you are creating specification for the components in for the page, but we don't want, we want to create, if you need to have a different behavior inside the page, ensure that your component have another behavior that you can activate inside the page, not the page that set this rule, because you want probably in the future use this behavior in the another screen. So it's the component that have the own rules and the elements that have their own rules, not the screen, not the page.
And it's important to apply the styles to the elements and then reapply it in every screen you want.
You can create a new behavior, but don't depend the screen or the page where you are using your component or your element.
Yeah. Okay. Now that we have talked about the basics of atomic design, I will show you how this logic applies in the real world example. So here I have a page of the Airbnb site. I think that everyone has already used Airbnb even once. So as I said previously, a page like we are seeing now is an organism, a complex group of pieces.
Yes.
But it can also be only a section of a page. So this can also be an organism, this part of this page.
And you don't choose this part as an organism because you want, because as I recall, the Airbnb have also this screen without the map. In another, I think it's in another screen, they are using this organism in another screen. So that's why you recall it organism, because it's a piece of code, of experience, of components that will be used in another screen. Can be an organism also.
Yeah, the main purpose is to reuse in other screens, not only at this one. Mm-hmm. So inside this organism, we can see some HTML elements, like for example, titles, paragraphs. We can see icons as well.
Mm-hmm. And we can identify elements. Sorry, Rodrigo. So in my mind, as a front-end developer, for me, elements in the screen will be the elements that I'm using directly in the screen without inside the components. That's right. Okay. Right.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. You can see it, and you can see that it can be further broken down. You see a title. You can divide it anymore.
Okay. In this case, we have an icon, a text, a title, and another text. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Yes. And then when you see that you can broke down even more, there are molecules or components, like we can see on the screen. If you look at some components, you can see that you can further broken down in more atoms or more components.
For example, here we are seeing the header. The header is a component, a molecule, because have different because have different functionalities, and also I can see that probably we have also another component inside the other, but the other it's the first main component. We have a map. In this case, a map it's a component because have the zoom controller, interactions, a map. So it's a component because have behaviors not only about styles but also in terms of functionalities. And also I can see that we can see a group of buttons, but the button is an element. Why we decide that this is a group, a component? Because I can say that it's a button. Each button will be an element.
Yeah, but as only as they are grouped together in function as one, they become a component or a molecule in this
it's
case.
Because if functionality, they are related. Okay, yeah, they are exactly. Depending one of the other.
Each one. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, and also we can see the cards from the upper. Yes.
Yeah, and we can see here that inside of this component, here we can see the card that we saw previously on this screen.
Mm-hmm.
We can also, inside of this, see more HTML elements and more components. For example, the titles, the paragraphs, the icons, we can see as HTML elements. And then we can see also some components like the slider of the images.
So the slider, it's a component, why?
Yeah, it's a component because it's not only an image, it has an action. It's actually a slider with different images that you can turn and slide because it has an action.
The like button, why it's a component?
Yeah, that is a great example. It is a component because if you look at an icon without any action, that would be an element, mm-hmm. an atom. But in this case, because when you click on this icon, on this art, you will see some action. Mm-hmm. You will add it to the favorite. It becomes a component because it has an action in different states.
Because we don't have an element from the native browser, from the native system that reproduces this. So we need to create a component, probably with two icons or one icon that changes styles. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's a component, because don't exist in the native behaviors. Let me say something, it's important.
Mm-hmm.
In the past years, in the recent years, we saw the new elements coming. For example, I can say the range slider. The range slider, a few years ago, we don't have range slider as an element. Today, it's an element. So pay attention that the browsers will be updated with the new controllers, with the patterns that it's common to use in the web browser. So today, for example, the button like can be a component, but in the future, we don't know, because the browsers can integrate this behavior inside and create an element. Okay, it's an element because you cannot change. If you don't change it, it's an element. It's not native. We only can apply stats.
It is great that we are seeing more elements coming to the HTML.
Yeah, it's common today.
So now that we saw a life example, I will go a little back and make a recap of what we have told until now, and then I have a quick challenge for you. So let's recap. Atoms or HTML elements are the absolute fundamentals of your system. They can be further broken down. Then we have molecules or components that are a group of atoms bonded together. They are simple groups of UI elements functioning as one. And then you have organisms or pages or a group of components that are complex components formed by multiple groups of molecules and atoms.
Exactly. In the first step, look to the screen. It's an organism. Don't go in detail. It's common, not only about UI design, but also in development. Try to grouping of components to create another organism. But think that when you create a component, or in this case, a component or an organism, this type of pieces need to work alone in all situations, okay? This is important. Are patterns that are isolated that can be work alone or together with another component.
Exactly. So now that we already recap, let's play a game. Here I have the main page of Spotify. I think that you already saw this one as well.
And I want to or iMusic because I created an application.
I'm not sure. So I want you to identify on this page which number is an atom, which number is a molecule, and which one is an organism.
Yes,
I will. Yeah, I will let you have a few seconds, yes. And then I will show you the answer.
But let's review this screen. So if I look in detail to this screen, the left side I have a component because I believe that menu can be isolated and it's have their own behaviors. So in the left side, probably we have a component or a molecule. In the top side, I can see with the update button, upgrade button, and also the user info. It's another component, the top bar, yeah, exactly. The right side can see another component because have elements, many elements inside who can group as a component. And I can see the title. The title is not a component because I can create a title only with a
HTML element, right?
It's an HTML element, exactly. So and the other one, the album card. I think I didn't miss anything. The album card, probably. I don't answer, but I believe it. Let's go. Let's see.
Okay, I think that you already had time to find which number is it's related.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So the answers. Number one is an organism because it's the page. It's a complex a group of other components and elements. Number two is a molecule. And number three is an atom.
Exactly. I think it's easier because you explain well. I think everyone are aligning with us.
Yeah, I think so. Okay, but we can go. We already saw that this card is a molecule, but we can go deeper and analyze what are the elements inside this one. So if we can see that inside this molecule, we have three other elements. These ones are the image, that is an HTML element. A title, that is also an HTML element. And then a paragraph, that is also an element.
Yes, let me say something. We are saying that the third, it's an atom that can be text element. The right way is to say it's a paragraph, okay? Paragraph elements, because the heading can be a heading one, heading two. It's when you design the interface, will be easier when you try to match the right element in the HTML. If you know the HTML element, if you don't know, will be a great tool to design the interface. But if you try to match to the HTML elements, also we have in our own UIKit all HTML elements that can help you design interface. But in this case, I think the third will be a paragraph. Let me say another thing related with this. We are talking about a component. So the album card, it's a component. Mm-hmm. But as you said, we have three elements inside. Why I cannot say that we have three elements inside avoiding a component. So why I create a component? I believe yes, please.
In this case, I think the shortest answer is because as we can see on the screen, we can reuse this component in many times. Exactly. And here we can see actually another thing that is about the styles that we talked before. So this component as a styles, which one of these elements has styles, but we can see that in which one of them they made exceptions on the styles directly on the component, and that is the image of the album. And this one is a really good example of how you can make exceptions on the component, right?
Yes. So as I understood, when you take a decision to create a component and don't use separated elements inside the page, it's because it's a pattern that will be repeated in the list, in different screens. So when you repeat design patterns, you create components. So you isolate the pattern as a component. Yeah. Yes, good.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so now that there is still one question left, we already saw that there are three groups of pieces, the atoms, molecules, and organisms. But I still have one question. Where do I document all of these pieces? Where do I put them? So the answer is a style guide. In the next slides, I will tell you what is a style guide and how can you make your one for your company or your brand. So style guide, what it is? In a few words, a style guide is basically a document that contains all the elements needed to develop an interface. Mm-hmm. And this document is created usually by a UI designer, and it is what developers use as a resource to create interfaces. These guides promote a cohesive and coherent design across all pages, and even between different interfaces of the same company or the same brand. And by having a coherent design across all interfaces, you will build a stronger brand. But what is the relation between a style guide and atomic design? So by using atomic design on this guide, it means that all the UI elements are connected to each other. And when you need to change, for example, let's say a color, you can change it directly on an atom, and then all the other pieces that has that atom will automatically change.
Yes.
So this is why it's so important.
This is something more technically. Mm-hmm. So it depends which tool you are using, how to do it. But as I understand, in front end, we call variables or blocks. So as I understand, you will create symbols or rules that you can apply in different elements and in different patterns. For example, you said primary color. So you can create a rule primary color, and you can apply primary color in different components or different atoms, in this case, elements. And when you change the primary color, all atoms will be affected, right?
Yeah, exactly. You can specify the primary color as a symbol, and then all the atoms that you want to put that color, you assign to that symbol. And then when you change it on the principal symbol, you change it in all the parts that has that style.
Mm-hmm. We do this in development, but it's important to do it also in design.
Okay, now after I tell you what is design systems, a style guide, sorry. Now I will tell you what is the process to design atomic interfaces.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's go. So after the user experience phase is done, and after the UI designer make a mood board and the client has approved, the next wiser thing to do is to make a style guide even before the designing the interface. So before we think about atomic design, it's important to define the basic styles of our style guide, because the atoms that we are documenting will drink styles from here, from the basic styles. Let's start by...
Go ahead.
So the first step you need to do is to define the typography styles. You should start by choosing the font or fonts, but just be aware that you shouldn't have more than two fonts. And once you choose the font, you should also specify the text styles. For example, the heading one, the heading two, the heading three, the body, links, labels, and many more.
One of the next steps probably will be styles, the elements, the atoms. But when you are choosing a font, you need to test it. So you can do it this before. So starting form to design, to apply styles to the atoms that corresponds and represent the fonts family and font styles.
Yeah. So after the typography is defined, you should also define the colors palette. And you can divide this step by four categories. The first one is the brand palette, where you define the primary and secondary colors of your interface. Then the extended palette with all the complementary colors that you want to use. You can also specify the neutral palette with all the gray colors that you want to use on the interface. And then the semantic palette as well, with all the information, the success, the warning, and the error colors.
Exactly. So let me say something in terms of colors. Yeah. The colors is not typically when you are defining the colors, probably you feel that you are limited. So you will be limited in the future because you only can use these colors. Obviously, in the first moment when you are defining the colors, we don't know exactly which colors we will need to finish the style guide. Mm-hmm. So it's not a limitation, but it's a base step. When you are designing and defining the colors, you already know when you need a new color, you need to justify and give a strong feedback to create a new color. Because when you have many colors, it's difficult to manage. So starting from a list helps you reduce a number of colors in the future.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that it's closed. It means that when you have a new color, you need to justify.
Yeah. And I think that is why it is so important to specify these styles on this phase, because I think, for example, we can see on the neutral palette, if we don't specify the gray colors, you will end up on the design of the interfaces, you will end up with hundreds of gray colors. And then if you have already a neutral palette before we move on to the interfaces, I think that will be a great idea.
And you are not joking. It's real. Yeah. It's happened. Yeah. 100 great colors already happens in our projects. So style guide, avoid it.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so now about the design patterns. This is not a mandatory step. I don't think it's as important as the other tools we already talked about. Mm-hmm. But to maintain the coherence between all the pages, I think you should also define these ones. And they can be rules for spacing. They can be rules for shadows, border radius, mm-hmm. And more.
It's only to help you maintain the consistency, because the user learns with consistency. For example, the shadows. When you add shadow to something, you are setting a different importance to this content. So if the cards have shadow, have more relevance comparing with another card that don't have shadow. So it's important to have this type of rules to share the content with the user, and the user can learn with your design, with your rules.
Yeah. Okay, and last but not least, even inside this, in these basic styles, it is also important to start documenting the icons that you will use on the interface. You can start by document the ones that you think that are the most important ones. And then as you define your style guide, you come across other necessities, and you can complement this library with more. It's an open library. You don't have to close in this phase.
Yes, icons, it's a great tool to promote user experience. Pay attention to don't use many icons, because user learns with your icons. So icon can represent an action. If you can represent an action, a pattern action with an icon, user already knows what this means.
Yeah, and it's a great way of communicating. So it's really important to choose wiser the icons that you want to use. Okay, so after you have all the basic styles defined, as we could see, you can start styling your atoms. And I say style and not design. Why? Because atoms are HTML elements, like we already told. So they already exist on your browser. All you need to do is give them styles. Mm-hmm. Some examples of atoms are buttons, checkboxes, tables, dropdowns, text areas, and many more.
So it's a good way to identify an element comparing with a component. So if I only can give styles to this element, it's an element. If I can change the element, will be a component. So it's native. An element, it's a native from the browser. Components, it's something that it have customized it code.
Yeah. Well, one thing that that you also have to have in mind is that each atom can also have multiple styles. For example, if you look at a button, it can have primary button. You can have a secondary button. You can have cancel button. So it all depends on your needs, but you can use different styles on the same atom and define it that way.
What you are saying is that I can create patterns with the same elements. So a button, I can create a button primary and a button secondary. It's the same element with different styles.
Are
two patterns to use case. Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
All that changes is the styles, because the element you can change it.
Exactly.
And as you know, molecules are groups of atoms. So after you style the atoms, you can also make some molecules to improve the user experience. Some examples are button groups, accordions, cards, menus, and many more.
Yes, the button group is a good use case. I can talk about the platform, the OutSystems platform, because in OutSystems platform, you have elements, also you have widgets from the platform, and also you have OutSystems UI components. In OutSystems UI components, everything is a component because they don't have available elements. But with the UI widgets from the platform, you can have elements and also components. For example, you have a button that is HTML element. It's an element. But in this case, you have a button group in the widgets library. So it's a component. So it's difficult for who don't understand well the HTML, but it's a good case. This is not native, and this is a custom component or a custom element. So merge buttons with some behaviors, some actions. So it's a custom component. It's difficult, I know, to understand. It's not it's a key, but it's easier to manage. But it's difficult to understand what is a element, what is a component.
Yeah. And that's it. Here you have your style guide defined. And now you can start designing screens.
Okay, so I, as I understood, we start from the style guide with the basic, with atomic design methodology, I can say. And after this, we can create screens. But when I'm designing screens, great. When I'm designing screens, I feel sometimes, every time probably, that I need a new component, or I need to change the styles of the element, but I can do it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the style guide is open, so you can add what you want and delete what you want as you see the necessity to do. Exactly. But it's important to start before designing interfaces to have a base where you can start designing interfaces, and then you can change as you need.
Exactly. So you can have new components or change the element styles when you need. But you need to have, in the first moment, a base guideline, in this case, a base style guide, to starting design new screens.
Yeah. It's really helpful to have one before starting.
Great.
Okay, so we talked about style guides, and we talked about atomic design. And now I want to show you some of the common errors that designers do when they are making interfaces. And the majority of them affect the development.
So it's here, as a developer, that I can say bad things about designers.
Yeah, go ahead. That is the time. So let's start from the first one, not having spacing rules. And this is a problem because in our experience, what happens is that when you don't have spacing rules, you end up using different spacings in all of your interface. Mm-hmm. And it becomes really incoherent for the user to see.
Yes. In my experience, this is have two issues. Mm-hmm. One, it's related with developer. So when developer don't have the spacing rules, it's difficult for developers every time looking to the space, the right high fidelity, and this is not happen. They don't look in detail for the spacing because they have another things to do, many things to do. So if you have spacing rules, it's easier for them to follow high fidelity UI. So if you have spacing rules, you are assuring that probably they can follow 100% your design. And the other thing that is more important, in my opinion, it's, as I said, with the shadows rules in the spacing, the user also learn with you. So if you have a bigger space between different contents, the content relation, it's less comparing with a less margin, so less spacing. So you can share this feedback and this learn to your user, and they will learn with your spacing rules. So they can manage the related content with the different spacing rules. It's important. And for example, and they navigate in the first screen and second screen. After this, they can also learn, okay, I have different space. This is another section. I have a small page. It's a title, the content. It's important to manage this.
Yeah, and I think that having different spacings would be a nightmare to developers. Let's imagine if you have 16 pixels, then 17, then 18.
Yes.
That would be horrible. So the next one is forgotten spaces, forgotten status. For example, for buttons, there are five main status: the active, the over, the disabled, the focus, and an error. And in many times, UI designers.
For button, right?
Yeah, for buttons, yeah. And in many times, UI designers forgot to define some of the status, and that's when developers have to guess how that would be, how that would be presented. And that makes some incoherences in the design.
Yes. Let me say something related with the buttons. In this case, buttons have five different behavior states. Okay.
Yeah.
But each component have their own states. For example, if you are talking about button group, you have more states because you have the selected disable. Okay, pay attention on that. Another thing related with states is don't left to this to developer choose design rules. What happens if they need to choose? They will probably do something that don't follow your ideas, your style guide ideas. And the other thing, it's most common, they forget also. If they don't have rules, they will left the basic state from the browser, and this is also don't follow your style guide, your ideas.
Yeah.
Pay attention. This is the most common issue. Most common issue in design. Don't define the status because the designers don't know all status for all components or all elements. This is the main issue that we can understand. But if you have a good UI kit, you can solve this.
Yeah, and I think that you, if you have some doubts, you can actually Google it and see how many states you should have.
Yes, it's easy.
In a few seconds, you can figure it out.
But the good UI kit, in our case, we solve these behaviors and these issues, those issues with the UI kit. So a pre-built design that designers already know, I need to give state to the button, I need to give state to the link, I need to give different states to drop down. It's a way to don't forget.
Yeah. It's more simple and it's really helpful.
We are humans, so it's common that we don't know everything.
We all make errors and forgot about bug things. So the next error is colors with opacity. And as designers, sometimes we tend to experiment colors and experiment contrasts. We tend to load the opacity to see how it works and then leave it that way. And that becomes a problem after the designing part because that components that we are designing doesn't stay only in that place. They can be in any others places and with many more background colors.
Yes,
and
yes.
That could make
I think I can say that, yes, you can use it opposite. You can use. But the issue is you don't have probably the all behaviors available that you for your project. Where you are using the button, where developers will use the button, it's difficult to you have this type of behaviors available. So you cannot test and probably don't have time to test the button in those behaviors. So to reduce and to avoid this type of probably issues, it's a probably, we don't know, but happens many times, don't use opacity because you can represent the same color without opacity. So if you can avoid, probably you will avoid also another future issue.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if you have opacity, the button color, in this case, talking about the buttons, the color depends of the background. If you are using, for example, in the pop-up that have a blue color, and you are designing in the white background, the button will change the color.
Yeah, that becomes a real problem. Mm-hmm. So the next one is using odd numbers when aligning. And that is a problem because...
Even numbers.
Even numbers?
Yeah. Yes, even numbers.
And that is a problem because all the screens have odd measures. Yes. So when you align with even alignments, the interface doesn't stay aligned because there's more space in one side than the other.
It's related that the most common screens are represented with even sizes.
Mm-hmm.
So if we are applying a hot size, this means that I cannot align my component in the screen. But it's a basic state for the screens. But for example, for a card, if I set a odd size or an even size to the card, inside, if I have the avoid, if I use even, I use it and also inside, even for the card and also inside a button with a odd size, I cannot align the button. So one way to avoid this type of unalignments, so disalignments, I can use only, in this case, even size. It's better. It's a good way to solve this. Okay, we have another ways, but it's the best and simple way. Probably exist another ways technically, but for designers to learn this, to match with developers, in this case, for local development, the local development, it's a better way.
Yeah. So the next one is to have different styles for the same UI elements. And that's a problem when you are trying to build a strong brand and a strong interface, because it's important to maintain the same styles. Mm-hmm. So this is a common error when you are designing.
Mm-hmm. So this means that if you try to reuse patterns, every time that you will apply new styles, in the first moment, if you use patterns, I think I can say symbols in your tool, in your design tool, probably you need to use the component. You cannot change it, because if you change it, it will change in all places that where the component is used. So the first moment, you cannot do it. To do it, you need to create a new component, new pattern in this case. But you need to justify why I need the other color. And let me say something about this. This is a common mistake for UX. So in this case, imagine that I use the first calendar, the left side calendar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I know that, for example, the selected will be red, the selected day. And the other side, I have styles to blue. I have 100% sure that in the first moment, if the user tests the first calendar, for the second calendar,
he will be completely confused.
Behavior. So this type of patterns in terms of UI, in terms of behaviors, it's important for the user, because the user learn with your UI, with your experience.
Yeah, and if you apply different styles, you will be completely confused about what.
But in the first moment, if you are using symbols, probably you don't do that.
Yeah. So the last one is the lack of knowledge about UI frameworks patterns. Mm-hmm. And that is important. It is important to have at least one basic understanding about the framework UI you are designing for. Mm-hmm. So when you are designing, you can understand what is simple to develop, what is not simple, what is a custom component that adds more effort in the development phase to do.
Yes, let me say something. Mm-hmm. I believe that the user interface, the user experience, the UI interface cannot depend from the technology, in this case, from a UI framework. This is the truth. But if you are working, you are working with a team that are using the specific technology, for example, as out systems, as we promote, if you know better the UI framework, in this case, out systems UI, out systems widgets, will be a better designer. Because as I said, you have in your hands a key to reduce effort, a key to match the budget, and you can take decisions that spend less time or more time, but you need to know it. When you design something in your screen, you need to know it. It's already exists in the platform. To apply these tiles, I need 1 day or 100 days. This is very important. Probably we'll talk about it in the next slides, but this know the framework. As I said, if you are working with a team that use a specific framework, mm-hmm. You'll be a better designer and probably a good gamekeeper, a well gamekeeper, if you know well the framework. We don't have a way to know everything, but you have a way in your hands to learn more about this.
Yeah, I think that as a UI designer, you don't have to learn how to develop an interface, but it's really important that you know the basis and the limitations of the framework mm-hmm. you are working with.
Exactly.
Okay, so that's it for the common errors. And now I will leave to David, who will talk in the next slides.
Okay, so to finish, I will talk a bit about out systems. So advantage of using atomic design on the out systems platform and the low code. So out systems is a low code development platform. Okay, as you know, a low-code platform have many advantages, but we can talk about fast development, So you can be fast, you can deliver your projects in less time. Low code expertise needs. So it's common that the low code developer that are using OutSystems or another low code platform don't have the expertise to use open code, but they have the key because they know well the business from the clients. They have the knowledge to decide and to create applications, because we know that sometimes exists a big gap between client and developers, and we believe that local developers reduce this gap and can make the change. So, and also scalability and easy maintenance. You already know when you create a new application with OutSystems, you can do this fast, deliver applications in days, and also change this application in the future the better way and with less effort. So low code follows the methodology based in building blocks. Okay, what is building blocks? Pre-built pieces of code available to use. As an example, UI components, as we talked in the previous slides, cards, buttons, widgets. Utility functions, so functions to manage our data, and integration components, integration with another service, with another databases, and other widgets and other functionalities that are based in building blocks, pieces of code that you can reuse. Now, to enable and promote low code advantage, we need to follow the same approach in the design process. As I said, building blocks are used in the no code and low code platforms. So everything is a block. It was atomic, where atomic design connects with low code. So if we are talking about atomic design, about atoms, about molecules, about organisms, but in specific about atoms that is an element, about molecule that is a component. So we can say that an element, an atom, can be a block in my platform. A molecule can be a block in my platform. And also in an organism, if will be a piece, a part of the screen, can be a block. So we are following the same system, the same model, building blocks, when you are designing a style guide, a screen. So the atomic design methodology also promotes pieces that can be assigned to existing blocks. And this is easy to understand. When you are designing a screen, you already are mapping how the developers will implement the screen.
So this is why it's important to design, having in mind atomic design.
Exactly.
To bridge the gap between the design part and the development. Right.
It's like you are talking different language, but doing the same way. This is important. So you have power in your hands to decide how will be the architecture. Okay, how many components we have, how many organisms we have, if we have organisms in the screen, if you are using elements or not. So you have a power to decide it. Now, how atomic design can impact local projects? Okay, and also as a designer, I'm not a designer, but as a designer, you can make new friends in development team. Pay attention. Ensure that will be possible to develop the design prototype. As I said, you are designing an interface. If you follow in atomic design, you make our lives as a developer easier. With the atomic design, all screens already are composed by atoms and molecules, as you can see here in the example of atomic design. A good example, in the right side, we can see the map. The map is something that already exists in the platform. If I use this map, I can probably apply the map in my project in minutes. If you create, if you will use another map, another controller, probably I spend 1 month. So this is a, and I'm telling it true, 1 month. This is a key Yeah, and the game changer from your side. So you can decide the budget. The Atomic Design Methodology also promote pieces, as I said, that can be assigned to existing blocks. The example of the map is a good example because it's a widget that already exists in the platform. Everything will be shown and identified in the style guide. So if in the previous moment, in the previous step, designers deliver a style guide with everything available and designed and with all behaviors, developers already know everything that they needed to implement the project. So they already knows how exactly what is needed to implement the screens. In this case, we are talking about screens because the applications are separated between screens, are composite by screens. And manage the expectations and costs. So identifying what already exists in the platform in the first moment, what need to be created from the scratch, behaviors, needs that the platform doesn't answer by default, we can manage the costs. So in the first step, when we are designing a style guide, we need to know, okay, this component, as an example, you can see in the screen. And in the top, we can see that the title already exists, the image already exists, the card doesn't exist, and the other placeholder doesn't exist, but the slider already exists, and the other card doesn't exist, but the bottom menu already exists. So with this approach, I can say as a designer that developers need to create the card, the two cards, in this case, three components. I will design as a custom component in my style guide, all behaviors, and when I deliver it, the project, they already know what they need to create the project, because sometimes this type of expertise, we are talking about low code, need and cannot be done by local developers and probably have more costs, and the client need to manage this, the product owner need to manage this type of behaviors. So you have in your hands the power to decide the costs of the project, because if you create only custom components, probably don't fit in the budget. Pay attention on this. Okay.
And I think that is why it's so important for UI designers to know the framework you are working with, because even in the design phase, you can already measure the effort and the budget that you'll use.
And let me add something related with our experience. When clients call us for help, many times it's because they can't implement the user interface. Okay, the developers don't have this expertise. It's not from developer local developers to implement this type of customization. And the first thing that we do, typically or probably 100 times, 100% times, is review the style guides. So what we'll do is when exist. Okay, when don't exist, we need to follow the screens, try review the screens, refactor the screens to match all UX needs, all behaviors to in the first moment to the out systems components. And after this, analyze what is really needed and cannot be solved by out systems and create components. In the first step, we can reduce probably 50% of the budget, the first effort. And the second phase, we'll create the style guide, high fidelity style guide, to be easier for developers to try implement the screens without our help. But sometimes it's a challenge when we arrive to new projects and the design is already done. It's common to say, okay, we need 3 months to implement those components. And the client said, but this is the budget that I have for our project. It's because the design team doesn't manage well the budget. Don't follow the budget, okay?
Yeah.
And nowadays, atomic design is a requirement. There is no such thing as one-shot development anymore. What this means? One-shot development, I say that a few years ago, many time ago, when we developed a project, a website, an application, it was common to develop the software, and after 3 years, develop the software again with another features. Today, this is not happening anymore, because when you create a software, the software needs to be organic, needs to be new updates, need new features to answer the market demands, the market needs, the client needs. For example, if you are creating a new software today, probably next month we need to add a new feature. And the atomic design with atoms, molecules, with elements and components are essential to answer this agility, this behavior. So the application, the software, need to be agile, need to be flexible to answer as soon as possible to the market, because the communication is fast, we have new market needs every day, and the clients need to answer to this those needs. The atomic design can help the software to be more flexible, to receive new updates, to receive new features, and try to deliver the project and promote the low code, because low code is fast, it's flexible. If you are using atomic design, we follow low code.
Yeah, I think that would be impossible if you every time that you have to update the application with improvements, you will need to make everything from the beginning. It would be impossible. So using atomic design possibilitates that you can add whatever you want without many effort.
Yes, we do some assessments to our clients, and one of the main tasks in the assessments is identify and catch code in the screens that are not used as a pattern. So developers left the code inside the screen. When they need to change a feature, they need to change in all screens. This is one of the main tasks that we do when you review applications or factories. It's try to create patterns, create mm-hmm. something that are reused. Because if you are reusing, you will be more agile in the future.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, that's it. What's next? It's only to talk about, as you can see, we only talk about the bottom layer, about the methodology, comparing atomic with, in this case, building blocks. So what we talk about is connect design with development, because at the Interactive, what we do is work together. For example, our offers depends of UX, depends of UI, depends of front end. And that we believe that are the designers that make the difference today. Okay, because they have the power to decide the effort the project needs, the expertise the project needs, the budget the project have. Okay, so we believe that atomic design, in this case for out systems, for local, it's a key, essential key. But also in the software development, it's a goal for everyone. So in the next, what's next? In the next masterclass, we'll go deep and probably see Rodrigo inside our tool or our design tools making beautiful things. So the next step, we'll see creating a style guide with our hands and show you how we do it.
Okay, but next it's time for me to re-enter the conversation. I think you both of you were amazing, but now, as always, I have some questions for you to answer. Some of them which were leave in the chat box, and some others that I have already told you that the community has made in the research that we have done prior to this masterclass. So first of all, I would like to ask you this question. This was sent by Pedro Oliveira, a great friend of ours. So he says, a button is an atom or a molecule? Because a button can use different classes that are classified as atoms, but the button itself is a single asset that cannot be divided anymore.
I don't know if I understand. The button is it's an element, and also it's an atom, because an element is an atom. Right.
Okay.
Right. Yeah, and I think that is an atom and not a molecule, because it's on HTML. It's a browser element. So
it's a browser element. If you are adding another behaviors to the button, probably you need custom code. So will be a custom component.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think it covers it answers Pedro's question. The second question I have is not properly a question that someone has sent. It's the first poll that we have made in the chat box today, and we asked the ones that were listening to us that they think that a layout is an asset, a screen, a resource, or a style. And it caused a little bit of a doubt, and I think that probably you, David, are the most suited person to answer this. What do you think a layout is?
If you are talking about technical part, it's a layout. Layout is a component, okay? If you are talking about atomic design, layout is a component that can receive content. But following the answers, so I can say that it's not a style, it's not a resource, because a resource can be movies, images, font icons can be a resource. It's not a screen, because the layout, it's a main structure of the screen, or can be a layout, can be a structure inside the component also. I think it's not a correct, but asset can be assigned to a layout, but assets can be also, for designers, can be images. So in my opinion, can be an asset, but the term asset is not totally correct for me. So that's why we have different opinions, because the answer is not obviously because I can say name it assets as a component. Sometimes I say that, our component is our assets library. But for example, for designers, assets can be an image. Library of images can be an our library of assets. It's not simple to answer, but the simple way, I think it's an asset, but because the asset is not the correct naming.
Okay. I think it covers and kind of solves the doubts that were on the ones that were listening to us, and that answered the poll that I said. So now I have a few more questions that the community has brought to us. And the first one, I think it's more suited to you, David, is this methodology only for low code?
Okay, no. But in my opinion, in low code, they have more impact comparing with another technologies, in low code and no code, okay? Because in low code you can match almost 100% with the building blocks that you have in low code platform. So if you can use atomic design, you are matching the same work model in the platform. Okay, but it's not only for low code, because this is doesn't born in low code. Atomic design can be used, and I think today it's used for all projects. Because if you are working with an open source project, you create something from you have a bottom framework, probably a UI framework, but not also UI, probably a server-side framework. So in my opinion, it's not only for low code, obviously, but have more impact in low code.
Okay, and I think you are right, David. The second question I have, I think you can both answer this one, but I think that Rodrigo is more suited to this. Is can I make a style guide after I designing the interface?
Okay, so I don't think that is a great idea. But if you already have the interface, it's always important to make a style guide, and you can understand a little more about what you have done and spot some issues doing that. But in the next project, I think that would be a great idea to start from the style guide and then move on to the interface.
Let me say something. I think it's not impossible, but it's a hard thing to do it, create a project without a style guide. Because it's a project will be small with 10 screens. Yes, you can manage because you know everything about the project, all components and all, so probably you have in mind. You can do it. But as I said, the software need updates and need new features. In the next month, you need to manage and create probably new screens or also change the screens. Mm. If you don't follow the style guide or atomic design in this case, you have hard work to do it. I think it's impossible, okay? And typically, when developers don't use the style guide, when designers don't use the style guide, developers have a hard life because they left many, many mistakes.
Okay. Thanks for your contribution, David. I think you were right. The third question I have, and I think this one is also for Rodrigo, it is, which tools do you use to design interfaces?
Okay, so at Interactive, for many years, we used Sketch with InVision to publish and to send for development. But now I think we are merging for Figma. There are still some projects that need to be done in Sketch, and there are some clients that we already have done the style guide and many projects, and we have to make them in Sketch. But new projects, and when it makes sense, we are starting to come more and more to Figma our main tool.
And I know that
I can add something about that. I can share with you that OutSystems are promoting three tools: Sketch, Figma, and Adobe XD. Okay, those three main tools probably in the future will be connected better with OutSystems, with UIKits and other things in the community. If you are choosing in the moment a new tool, and if you work with OutSystems regularly, use on one of those main tools. Obviously, in my opinion, Figma today it's the cover well the UI kit and tools that you can use around OutSystems.
Yeah, and I can agree with both of you. Me, the marketing guy, I'm already using Figma, so
for a different purpose, not
for only a basic purpose. I don't have the I don't have the talent that you have, Rodrigo. Okay, but okay,
but it's really versatile. The Figma, you can do
you can do literally everything. And okay, so we come to the last question. Okay, and I think you. I want you to stick with me to understand this one. And this question is, how can I ensure that what I design is matched with what already exists, elements and framework components?
Okay, so...
How are you?
I think to solve that, you should use the UI kit that OutSystems have. If you are using the OutSystems framework or any other, I think that you should download the UI kit and would be more easy and more simple to make the design.
Yes, and I think it's almost impossible to ensure 100%. Okay, we have inside in our process we are using a UI kit. We have also our own UI kit, and we have a process to review UI design to try understand if everything is aligning with the platform. But with that, we cannot ensure 100%. And we are talking about developers that know 100% about the UI framework from our systems. But the human cannot review 100% if it's possible or not implement this. So the best way is, as Rodrigo said, using UI kit. Probably you cover 90%. The other way, it's know better the platform and the behaviors and try to make friends with development team. They can give some feedback. I think the best way. So we cannot follow the ensure 100%, but with UI kit, it's the best way to do it.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think we are done with the questions. And by being done with the questions, we are also done with this masterclass. So thank you, Rodrigo. Thank you, David, for sticking with us and for giving your insights on atomic design. I would also like to thank everyone who stood by and has listened to this masterclass until the end. And that's it. I will also want to say to you that we are preparing more content like this, more masterclass, more videocasts that we are preparing for our YouTube channel. And I want you to be a part of it. I want you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, to leave the like on this video, and also follow Interactive social media, in which we are going to let you know everything that we are doing here on our YouTube channel. And without further to say, if you have any more questions, this video will be available for you to re-listen if you want. And you can leave a comment that we are reaching you as soon as we can. So that's it. Thank you, everyone, and have a nice day.
Thank you, João. Yeah. Thank you, Rodrigo. Have a nice day.
Bye.
Yeah.